afternoon, everyone, and good to see you all. I'm making a slight shift in the kind of topics that I was taking, but actually it is not very different. In fact, I'm more like bringing in the body work into the day-to-day management parlance and going to talk about it. And I always want to say this, you know, though I say I'm Dr. Sanjyot Pethe, I'm not a medical doctor, I'm a doctorate in organizational weaving. Yeah, I'm an academic doctor. And I am getting into this field of trauma healing and stress management and resilience, and that is where I decided to choose this topic, talk about biases, but also connect it to our well-being. How is it related to well-being, and how do our biases play out? So the intent of the session is, of course, also talk about how our experiences constantly change our perceptions, and then also talk about what are the biases that are impacting our decisions on a day-to-day basis. And there are people who feel that no, this is reality, everything that we are seeing is reality, but I think reality is known to very, very, very few people and known at very few times. Most of it is our perceptions, and how we look at the world around us can determine a whole lot of things that happen to us. There is this famous model, it's called Johari window. Very nice. That is very nice that people already know about
it. Fresh in the mind.
Yeah, it is fresh in the mind that you talked about it. So Johari window is a very usually applicable actually in interpersonal situations, but I thought I'll bring it in a individual decision making space as well. So just to quickly recap, when we are interacting, when you are interacting, the way we see the world, we see it through this window.
Yes.
So there are things that are known to us, there are things that are not known to us, and then there are things that are known to others, and there are things that are not known to others, and when they interact, that is how our perceptions get created. So what is known to us and known to others is fairly obvious. Things which are public, you know my name, you know my education, you know a whole lot of things about me if we are interacting often, or right now just before we started this talk we were talking about a particular place, and so all that information is now in the public domain, and that's why it's called public. Between any two people there are some things which are known to both the sides. Then there are things which are known only to me, which are not known to others, which is something which is my private self, of course, which will change from person to person. So there will be some people who will know more, but there will still be parts of me which no one except me knows. And so things that we think about, things that go through our mind but we don't express it to others, memories that we don't share with other people, they all become a part of our private self. Then there are things which other people can see but you cannot see. And a very classic example actually is with, especially with people who are struggling through stress and mental health issues. They don't realize that their body is giving a message to other people. The other people may not be able to decipher the message. So they may see you as angry, they may see you as sad, they may see you as tense, they may see you as lacking energy, and you may feel, why are they saying that? Because you are not feeling, you are under somebody. So you are actually blind to what the other person can see, and that's why it's called as blind self. And a whole lot of it is, it depends upon how willing you are to seek a feedback, who is the person who is giving you a feedback, how is the feedback being given. All that aspect is your blind self. And then there is an area in all of us which is neither known to us nor known to other people, and it is the unconscious, it is the unknown, which we are now, I mean, I am increasingly now, I hear when I talk to doctors or even to other people or my clients, people are now becoming conscious about the unconscious. Now they are understanding how our well-being actually gets dictated to a great extent by our unconscious, without realizing, which we don't know, others don't know why we behave in a particular way, but that is what happens. In fact, that is also a place of our intuition, where we are not aware of what is happening, but if we can connect to our body, if we can connect to our sensations, then it really allows us to know, it allows us to reduce this window. So actually, for us to be effective, the blind and unknown window needs to be
small,
and the private and public needs to be large. You can't have a zero private anyways, and you cannot have a public, there will be public spaces which will get shared, but blind will make you more, if blind is shorter, you become more effective. Similarly, if your unknown is shorter, you become more effective and more healthy. But some level of unknown and blind will always stay as long as we are alive. It happens because, so we have spoken in this forum about how small babies are responsible. So some aspect of it will always remain unknown. Some aspect of my initial life, first 2 years, 3 years, 4 years will remain unknown to me. But they may show up, it may show up in my body, in my reactions, in my behavior, in some kind of patterns, but it will stay in the unknown. And then there are variety of ways in which we can look at it, and we can evaluate our own decision in terms of how much it is being dictated by the unknown and by the blind. Yeah. That is why I thought that it is very important for, in a decision making context, for us to understand this this window. Like one of the things that is happening, particularly when people are dealing with excessive stress or they are dealing with a chronic illness or chronic pain which they can make no sense of, the doctors can make no sense of. Why is it happening? Why is the body reacting? You know, and one of the things that needs to be done is looking at where are we blind in terms of this pain. What do we usually do with such pain? We either use painkillers or we try techniques to do away with the pain. If we connect to that pain, maybe our decisions will be different. But yeah, I'm going a little ahead of myself, so let me move further. So how do we see the world? So what happens is that, like I'm standing here, yeah, some sensations are arising in my body and falling. I can't afford to, if I have to continue the talk, I can't afford to keep paying attention to that, because then I will only be doing that. But at the same time, they are happening. Some sensations are constantly happening. I am getting impacted by people sitting around here and by what happened just before I came in, and you know, maybe even what is going to happen after I step out. There are sounds of traffic that are coming in. There is a temperature that this room has at this point in time. All of this is impacting my sensations, and those sensations are generating feelings. So if I'm right now, I'm very comfortable, right? So the feeling is of joy, the feeling is of talking and, you know, seeing familiar faces and talking into something, talking about a subject that I'm happy about. So there is the sensation, and there is this feeling. Now if I don't pay attention to certain sensations which are sharper or more significant, and I don't pay attention to the emotion that is coming up, I may end up doing things which I will have no control over. So for example, if I've come in and something has happened, something not so pleasant has happened, okay, and I come in and I don't give my body a chance to settle the sadness or the anger, whatever has come up. I will be speaking what I am speaking, but there may be a sharpness in my voice, which will be picked up by other people. They won't know why, because my words are normal, simple. There is nothing happened in this space to generate that anger or sadness. So they will get a mix kind of a message. So it is very important that I am in touch with what are the sensations that are arising and what are the feelings that are arising. Our thoughts are informed, of course there is a circular relationship, but our thoughts are mainly informed by our sensation and our feelings. You know, that is why when you have pain, when you are in pain, very rarely will you also be happy alongside, because the pain sensation will generate sorrow most of the time. Yeah, it will generate sorrow most of the time. When that happens, your thoughts can go into a negative spiral. What is this pain about? Why is it happening? I didn't get hurt anywhere. Is there a tumor inside? Is there a problem inside? What has happened? Something is going wrong, you know. Your thoughts will start going into negative spiral. I don't know if you have observed it, but if you call up somebody and tell them I am having this pain and I don't understand what is going on, 9 out of 10 chances the person will tell you how somebody else had the same experience and didn't survive. One chance the person may say, oh, it may be nothing. But 9 out of 10 chances people will start talking about and will generate memories. And I don't think people are doing this on purpose.
No. They have good intentions.
They have very good intentions. They are asking you to be careful. But that is what these say. Because when I tell my negative story to somebody, that person's nervous system is also getting scared. So it is very important when that thought starts spiraling, you come back to body sensations. Because body sensations and emotions will move. They will not stay. Thoughts will stay and they will spiral. But anyway, so going further, so when those thoughts, and below those thoughts are actually your belief system. Our belief system over generations, for whatever reasons, they may be good reasons, but over generations has been to be careful, to be cautious, not take unnecessary risks, you know, quickly act. When it comes to health, act quickly, don't sleep over it, don't postpone it, you know. So that's the kind of belief system we have, which has come from our experiences, and those experiences decided for us what we will do as a result of that experience, what you will do. Yeah. So just let me give you an example. So I have this client who has had a lot of back pain all her life. She suffered a lot of back pain, and the doctors can't find anything wrong with her. I mean, she has gone to all kinds of doctors, and doctors have simply told her, this is all in your mind. I mean, it's completely psychological. We can't find out a single reason behind it. So we sat down, we had a conversation, I got her in touch with her body just to find out what could have happened. Now there are multiple things that could have happened. The back pain can be a result of some childhood trauma that is still sitting in the body, which has not released, or maybe even an adulthood trauma which has not got released. That could be one reason. Another reason, which is increasingly being told or these days explored, is what is called as generational trauma. That is something happened to my grandfather's grandfather, and the pain is with me now. 7 generations is what it is being medically proven. 7 generations of so many, you know, your parents, their parents, their parents. So we are talking about 7 generations trauma can be in your body. And that's why the pain can happen. Okay? So whatever it is, that thing is stuck now with her. Okay? So one, I said, could be your own trauma. Then I said there could be a generational trauma. And the third thing that can simply be is your habit into the body to avoid something. So, you know, I don't know if many people I notice, at a for particular type of things their head will start aching. For a particular type of things they will suddenly develop cough and cold. For a particular time they will suddenly fall ill. For this person we actually discovered that it was that she was, every time there was a need for doing something which required a lot of conflicting conversations, her back would start aching. Something, that habit that she has developed to meet the need to avoid, she has developed her backache. I mean, there is a author by the name of Dr. Gaber Mate who has written a whole book on how cancer also can sometimes develop just for the sake of patterns. How body can suddenly collapse because of just for the sake of patterns, for the sake of avoiding something. So what are your needs that those experience didn't meet and therefore you developed certain ways of behaving or ways of making decisions? You know, these are very simple small scale decisions which your body made at a certain point of time and it is showing up now. And what can you do to break that? So, essentially what we are talking about is, how do we appear? Yeah, we appear as language, I am speaking, body, the way I am looking right now or the way I am feeling in my body, and emotion. So, I can speak in a very plain, single tone, no emotion, it won't have any, it won't generate any impact. When you bring these three together is when the cycle of sensations to experiences can actually start breaking and you can make more further better decisions in terms of your own health and how your decisions are actually getting influenced, how the way you look at the world is getting influenced. So that's the context in which I want to present another model of how we actually make big decisions. Now these decisions are very, not small, but they are hidden decisions. These are not decisions that you consciously make. I'm sure this lady did not consciously decide that in order to avoid difficult conversation, let me have back pain. I'm sure it is her body which, because of the hidden emotions or generations of behavior, that her body decided. But even when we are making decisions, what all is playing with us? So when we look at certain beautiful pictures, so I have on screen, there are three pictures. There is a rose, there is a dog, a little puppy dog, soft toy kind, and there is a chair. Now, when we look at these images, different people, when I present this particular slide, when I'm in a training program or I'm talking to people, different, and I ask them to tell me what do they see on screen, I get different kinds of responses. Yeah, so there are people who will look at the rose and say it's a yellow rose. There are people who will look at the rose and say, oh wow, it's so beautiful, the yellow color is so bright, it's like hope. And then there are people who will look at it and say, oh, it's a picture of the rose on your screen. Yeah, so which is, all three are actually true for people. The same thing is with that dog. Some people get into a conversation around whether that dog is real or is it a soft toy. Some people call it cute. Some people say it's a puppy, it's a dog, you know, kind of. Same is with chair. So these are objects, but every object gives you a meaning. Yeah, sorry. The thought is different, the emotion is different, probably the sensation is different, depends on. So if you have been bitten by a puppy, the sensation will be very different from if you have had a puppy at home and you have worked, played with it. Your sensation and reactions are going to be different. Why does this happen? So in our mind, there are six decision makers. Okay. Yeah, I know on the screen right now there are two, but actually there are six. So, there is an external view that we have about objects and events and people, and there is an internal view that we have. So, three external and three internal. The first one is called as empathetic outlook, which means for the external world, when I see the world, do I see for its, look at it for its inner, what it generates as inner. So if it's something very inner, then you look at a yellow rose and you never say it's a yellow rose, you say, oh wow, what a beautiful rose. You know, it's not even a rose actually, it's a picture. But that's what it does to you, right? And then there is an intrinsic view which is about your own sense of self. Who are you? What do you think you are? Who do you think you are? Where are you? What is the kind of position you have in the world? The second is practical thinking. Or rather, it's actually the other view of looking at what the object brings for the outside, and in the inside it is role awareness. So what it means is, so for the outside, for example, it's a yellow rose, it's a rose because of the shape that it has, yeah, it's a picture. You're talking about things which are not intrinsic to that object but external to the object or extrinsic to the object. So that is your, for the outer world it's your practical thinking, and for the inner world it's your role awareness. What is the kind of role that you are coming from? So maybe in at home you might say, oh it's so beautiful, it's so sweet, but maybe in a professional context you might not say that because you are aware of the role that is happening. And then the third is the systemic, which is the overall, you know. So you might, if you look at the picture of the rose, you may say, oh red rose is better, or yellow rose is for friendship and red rose is for love and whatever, pink rose is for something, white rose is for something, and so on. So you are doing a systemic judgment. Where does it fall into your system? And then there is also, what is your own sense of direction? What is it that you like? What is it that you want? Now this is about a small object and picture. What happens when we are making a decision? So for example, you're making a decision about, so I have an experience of, I had this severe back pain and I lived with it for about one and a half months before I actually went to the doctor. And then the tests and all that took another 1.5 months. So it was like a back pain of whole 3 month duration, where some days I went to office, some days I worked from home, and I was still working and I was doing that. And then there came a point when the doctor told me that I'm a little confused between two things. This can either be a spine tuberculosis or it can be cancer. Okay. And I want to rule out the possibility of cancer. Because if it is spine tuberculosis, then we have time. If it is cancer, we don't know whether we have time or not. And biopsy takes anywhere between 7 days to 10 days for the biopsy report to come. So he said, let's do biopsy immediately. Let's do it Saturday. I'm available Saturday morning. I'm sitting in his office on Thursday, saying Saturday morning, you will do. I said, okay. I stepped out and something happened to me. I don't know what exactly happened, but something happened to me.
It's not the case for me.
I got scared. Okay. And I went to another doctor. She is a friend of an uncle of mine. So I went in that capacity. I did not go to meet her as a doctor. And I went to her and I said, I don't want to do biopsy. I'm saying no. I'm not willing to do. She said, okay, let's cool down. Let's talk to the doctor once and see what has happened. So she called the doctor and the doctor said, I think it's 1% chance of cancer and 99% chance of spine tuberculosis, but I want to rule out the possibility. I don't want to start treating for spine tuberculosis and later find out it was cancer. So I just want to rule out. So this person said, okay, let's go ahead and do the biopsy. We'll see now what the results are. So she said that, and I calmed down and I decided to go for biopsy. Why am I telling you this story in this context? So what really happened was, look at the empathetic outlook. Again, the empathetic outlook was played out in terms of, okay, the doctor is confused, the doctor is not sure, unnecessarily I have to go through this, okay, but I can't talk to him. If he gets angry, what will happen? So I don't want to tell him anything, let me go to somebody else and let that person, you know, find out what's the reality. Okay, look at my own sense of self. My own sense of self was, I can't decide this. I can't do this. I cannot decide this. I don't understand these things. Suddenly, all my confidence of a professional, of knowing so much, all vanished. You know? And I said, no, but I can't argue with a doctor. Somewhere, belief system, you can't argue with a doctor. Your thoughts, your feelings of fear, but you're not in, I was not in touch. Those days I was not so much in touch with my body and my feelings. So I had this feeling of something sinking, which was actually anxiety. What if it is cancer? What will I do? So it was that anxiety. In the process, what is the decision that I made? I told the doctor, no, I will come back to you. I did not fix the Saturday appointment, and then the actual biopsy took place in the next week, in the following week, 2 days later. Fortunately for me, it was not cancer. But in a way, by my own action, what did I do? I delayed the diagnosis by 3 more days. Already 3 months I have suffered. I need a diagnosis and I need a treatment to start. But what did I do? In the process, I pushed the diagnosis forward. So understanding that again there was practical thinking was also clouded, because the practical thinking was not that, okay, if it is cancer anyway, nothing can be done now. Biopsy will not give you cancer. Biopsy will only tell you whether you have cancer or you don't have cancer. It will not do that. So what was my practical thinking? Practical thinking went in somewhere else. That did not happen. Then role of awareness, of course, did not play a part in this. But system judgment also. How much of this? I could have asked the doctor. I could have told my own doctor, the doctor who was asking me to take biopsy, that I am feeling scared. I am feeling afraid. Because in between, whoever I spoke to was saying, oh my God, they will do biopsy near the spine. Sometimes they can make a mistake. You may become bedridden. All those things also I heard during that particular period of time. So what it tells me, what it told me that time, and I was already teaching this concept to people. And later on I sat down and I really looked at it and I said, you know, what if I had sat down and said, okay, my empathetic piece is saying this. My self-awareness is this. My self-judgment is this. This is my role awareness. This is the practical thinking aspect of it. And then there is a systems judgment. Looking at how much time I will spend here, how much time I will spend there. Yes, business decisions are worse because then they also take into other kinds of biases that play out, which I will talk about. But this in itself creates a lot of bias. If you pay too much attention to maybe empathetic outlook, for example, or too much attention to practical thinking, or too much attention to systems judgment, or your own sense of direction. You know, people speak about, when they talk about health, I hear a lot of people say, I'm very stressed but I don't have time to take a break. Okay, so you will take a break when you are no longer stressed. Or I was like sharing with someone that, you know, people go on vacations to visit places, and because like going to certain places can be costly, and of course you've got a 2 week break, you may not get the same break again for the next 6 to 8 months. people fit in whole lot of stuff in that. They want to see 5-6 places, they want to cover distances, they without realizing that this is vacation. And what's wrong if you have to visit the same place twice to explore it fully? Or what's wrong if you seek only 5 places but having a good break and vacation? There we are overemphasizing practical thinking. It's practical, of course. I'm going to spend, say if I go to Europe today, I'm not going to go to Europe every year, and it will still cost me about at least, I don't know, but maybe at least 2 lakhs,
yes.
2 lakhs, something around that. So I would, once I go there, I would like to cover as much as possible, but then the whole idea of visiting a place and having a vacation gets destroyed. Same thing people do with their health. Same thing people do with their certain plans. Without not realizing that when you focus too much on practical thinking, you lose out on other things. And there are 6 possibilities for us to look at for every significant decisions that we make. And that is what creates our biases. So what happens when you have a bias, positive bias with empathetic thinking? What really happens is that you are then no longer focusing on so much of caring is not required. You know, like see, it's things like I began to learn that a little bit of headache, little bit of stomach ache, and I will take a paracetamol. Okay, little bit of acid influx and I will immediately take an Acilock. Little bit of fever and I will immediately take a Crocin. Too much empathy towards myself, or for that matter towards other.
And conditioning.
Because too much focus on quickly doing away with pain. I stopped doing it. So the pain would stay and then the pain would go away. If it persisted, instead of 1 day, 2 days my stomach pains, then I am going to a doctor and taking a medication. But otherwise, 1 day my body can tolerate it. That came when I overcame this bias of, and this we do with others also, we do over caring for other people, protecting them, doing all kinds of, and it actually troubles the other person. So the negative bias, the positive bias actually creates a lot of pressure. The negative bias actually ignores sensitivity. If you don't pay the appropriate attention, then the negative bias is that you are not engaging with the person. You are not really engaging and relating to that person. When we are neutral is when we are truly human. When you are able to see the pain for what it is, but you don't overdo that. Practical thinking, of course, is required. All of us need it. But when we put too much attention to it, we are resourceful, we are solution focused. But sometimes we can go overboard. We become too materialistic. We don't realize that besides practical thinking, there are other things that are required. When there is a negative bias, then we can make the mistake that I told about, that I just threw the practical thinking out of window. What I want to avoid cannot be avoided, and therefore I needed to avoid the delay. Instead I ended up avoiding the diagnosis for some time. And if it is neutral, then that is where we are the safest, when we are able to take appropriate action. And these are all the external things. So how do we compare, say, between doctors? How do we compare between modalities of health? How do we compare between how much we will spend in different aspects? How do we compare how much of relationship time we are going to engage in? How much we are going to take care of ourselves? How much we are going to pay attention to other people and stuff like that? The third external aspect is the systems judgment. Really looking at what is it that you can do, what is it that the system can provide. When we have a negative bias, we actually distress the system. You know, I have had occasions in my life where I needed to reach out to the police, for example, for protection. And my experience was amazing. It was a very, very beautiful experience for me, where I was helped appropriately, absolutely appropriately. Suppose I had not gone there, I would have spent the whole time in fear. Instead, I went there. That came from a appropriate or rather neutral outlook towards the systems that we have. When we have a negative bias, when we say, oh, this system is not good enough, it's not worth it, it's we actually create fear, we generate fear towards the system. That is what happened with the doctor. I automatically assumed I can't share this with the doctor. Whereas my doctor did not even, when this other person called him, he did not even ask her, why are you calling? He answered very patiently exactly the question that he was asked, like a very objective person. The people will question and he can answer. But I did not even bother to ask him or question him or tell him that this is how I am feeling. And when you are neutral, then you are open and objective, and then you are able to enforce appropriate authority. Then is our own internal self. And I think this is my perspective. This I'm not sure about this, but I believe in this. That your own sense of self is very, very important, particularly in case of your health. How much do you know yourself? How much are you connected to yourself? And how much do you trust your own resourcefulness and your own capabilities? Actually can make a difference between how healthy you are and how healthy you are not. How much do you, like when I came in touch with somatic experiencing, the trauma management certification that I have done, I learned this, that the more I trusted myself and appropriately balanced my diet, the easier it was for me to reverse my diabetes. I have actually reversed my blood sugar condition because of the trust that I had in this process, in what was happening and how I was connecting to my body. So when you're neutral, you have an objective self-awareness, you appreciate things around you, you appreciate yourself. When you're positive, it can actually go, you can go overboard. You forget to ask questions, you take unnecessary chances. When it's...
Neglect reality.
You neglect reality, yes, you neglect reality, you don't take that into account. When it is negative, then you have a desire to improve, but then you can also have a lot of self-esteem issues. Self-esteem issues actually come from a negative bias to us. Now, why am I saying it's a negative bias? Because you have it in you, you have a sense of self, but you are not giving it enough importance. You are not looking at, when I say negative bias, I mean you are not giving it enough importance. When I say positive bias, we mean you are giving it too much importance. Sometimes you also have to let go of that. Role awareness is something which I learned much later how it is related to. So when you play a lot from your role, what you actually do is that you take pride in good work, you do a lot of good things, but what you actually do is that you sometimes forget the self, which may be in clashing with the role. And this I saw a lot in terms of when I had gone for doing this work with cancer patients. I had done a session with the supporters, the caretakers, caregivers of the cancer patients. I had done a session, and one of the things that I learned there was that in the role, they forget to take care of themselves. And when that happens, it actually can have a negative impact even on the patient, because it burdens the patient, and because of the patient, you are suffering. So some kind of balancing is needed, some kind of understanding that role awareness is a good thing, but you also need to understand that you can't emphasize it too much. You also need to be able to take a break from that. And of course the sense of direction. So when you are, when, how, where are you going? What is it that you want to achieve? Especially these days when this whole obesity thing is so widespread, you know, people overdo how slim they want to be. So yes, it's good to lose weight, it's good to be slim and fit, but slim automatically does not equal to fit. Sometimes you can be a little more, you can have a little more weight, I'm not talking about obese, but you can have a little more weight and be more fit than somebody who is very slim and yeah. So what is your, when you take up a health plan or when you take up, when you decide to work on your health, what is the direction that you want to go to, and are you looking at that when make, when you are making your goals or when you are making your decisions? I think the, what I love about this model is that it takes entire gamut into account when you are making decisions. That is, it takes into account external things, what kind of relationships you have outside, and it also takes into account the internal things. And most effective decisions would be if you are able to look at all the six components together. So what are the implications then for this kind of decision making? Is that we have to also understand two things, which I'll right now take it as in very brief. There are two biases. One bias is called conformity and the other is called attribution. Okay. Google is one such space of conformity, where you search, something is happening to you, you take your symptoms, you put onto the Google, and then Google tells you that this could be the case, this could be the case, this could be the case. And if a whole lot of your circle also tells you, you automatically diagnose, and then you go to the doctor with the diagnosis. You know, that's that is conformity bias, where if the half the world is telling you this is it, you know, you tend to conform to the norms of the other, and that creates a bias, because then your decision making gets limited. In fact, one of the advice, so I was talking to one of the people who are teaching somatic experiencing, and I was asking that person that sometimes I look at my symptoms and I feel that maybe it is complex PTSD. And the one line reply this person gave me is, stop looking at the terminologies that are used, because they will confuse you. Instead, just look at the symptom that is impacting you, and forget whether it is a part of PTSD or depression or anxiety or anything else. Because otherwise a lot of assumptions will get created. The second is the attribution bias, where we tend to attribute what is happening to us to the causes we think has happened. In fact, this my spine tuberculosis is a classic case. I asked the doctor, why did it happen to me? Why should I get spine tuberculosis? So he asked me, do you go in pollution areas? I said, no, I travel in a car, so no. Is there? So he says, okay. So then, are you been eating outside? I said, no, I'm not been eating outside. So then he looked at me and then he said, maybe it was supposed to happen to you. So I was looking at him and he started laughing, and then he said, I don't know why it happened to you. I know it happened, I know how to heal you. I don't know why, but we attribute a lot of things to something that we find is rampant, or people close to us have seen it happening that way, you know. So it's like I hear different things. I hear things like, you know, if you have acidity, some people will tell me, don't have lime juice. Some people will tell me, have lime juice. You know, because it's vitamin C, have lime juice, don't have lime juice. So I finally started watching, while taking lime juice, does my acidity increase or decrease? decreases. Okay, I'm going to have lime juice. If it increases for you, please don't have. So that's the attribution bias. Second, understanding that how we see the world will impact how we are. So if you look at the world as very, very materialistic, then it will impact you in how you operate in the world. Or if you see the world with too much empathy, you will give too much empathy and you will not look for reality. We all have resources around us and also within us. And it's a good idea, especially when you hear a bad news, when you're too tired, when you're exhausted or whatever. Look for resources. Don't come home and switch on the TV and start listening to the news. You're already down, you are going to go further down. That is the moment for you to look at. And resources can be anything. It can be music, it can be nature, it can be a book you like to read, it can be talking to somebody, it can be even going and taking a bath and actually feeling the water falling on your body. It can also be a very, very good resource. So we have it. Connect to self and then look at all the six aspects when you are making the decision. Take everything into practical thinking is important. Everything cannot be intuition based. You have to look at what can work and what cannot work within your given resources. Of course, boundaries we talked about, and it is extremely important, but I think more important than boundaries is kindness. Can you be kind to yourself and to other people? You know, because in between there was this very rampant views were spreading that cancer happens because of negativity in you. You know, and then it really became, oh my God, if cancer has happened to me, I must be a very negative person. I mean, this is being very, very unkind to yourself and very, very unkind to people around you. Can you be very kind to yourself? You are ill, that's it. You are unwell, that's it. It's not because you are not a good person or because you have a lot of karma, accumulated karmas, which may be true, but you don't have to go there right now. Right now you have to be very, very kind to yourself. And of course, trust your intuition. Trust what in the moment, what it does. So I think this model, as well as the understanding of our own body, is something which is very, very essential for your health and for your wellness. Thank you.